I was out having coffee, and I thought everybody was going to join me. So I was asked to give a talk on the project we were working on, John. For those, just make sure everybody knows, John is the pan-European network that serves 35 countries, 35 European immigrants in Europe. And one of the activities on John is this activity called the test bed service. And that's what I'm going to speak about. So the notion of network testing, we have to evaluate our network concepts at scale. The closer to a realistic environment we can get, the better. So there's two issues we really have to deal with here. One is that testing can be damaging. It's not much predictable. It's going to fail, and it can take other systems and services differently in the process. And people don't like people to treat like crash test dummies, right? So they have real work to do. So we want to make sure that our test beds and our production services are not interfering with them. And building test beds is difficult. It's, you can do it in your lab with a little bit of effort. But then if you want to deploy this at scale, you have to contract for locations, the point of presences in the metropolitan area or across the wide area of your country. You have to deal with virtual circuits in between these pops. You have to deal with engineering operations, contracting. This can take literally, even for a small wide area network, it can take up to 6 months just to get the network in place before you even start the research. So what we want to do is we want to find a way of accelerating this process so that the ramp up time is reduced. It doesn't take as much effort, and it's safer for the line of batons, if you will. They're not get pounded by the experiments. So the requirements that were set out for the test bed service were: we wanted things to be user oriented. We wanted users to be able to find their own numbers. They had to have a rich set of resources so that the users could do lots of things that they would like to do. Have to be simple. You know, we don't want to have to have a PhD in order to use the service. We want it to be flexible enough to incorporate new technologies over time. You know, we don't always know what's going to be coming down the road in 2 years or 5 years. So we would like to be able to say, all right, you have some new device, a piece of hardware, or some new software process. We can integrate that into the test bed service as a resource, and then people can use it for their researchers to use it. The agility, the ability for a test bed to, a researcher to find their test bed, run an experiment, get results, analyze those results, and feed those results back into a new test bed should be quick. This cycle time allows us to make progress. And so we want this to be able to set up these networks quickly. When I say quickly, I'm talking about a matter of a few minutes rather than a few weeks or a few months. And we want to be able to modify them on that same kind of time scale. Security is utmost. And this is in two senses. One is we want these to be secure so that for any given researcher, nobody's going to break in and start messing with this network. And the other sense is that as that network is running experiments, that they don't interfere with other production services, only test beds or other facilities beyond their network environment. It needs to be reliable. This is not a research project, it's a production service. Right? So when a researcher says, I'm assigning my class to do everybody's built in teams, and we're going to go build a test bed network across Europe. That service has to be there, right? It has to be reliable. If somebody says, I need these facilities on Wednesday because that's when I have the instrument at CERN, then it has to be there. If we can't do that orchestration, then the research programs are going to go. And ultimately, this whole thing has to stretch across the globe. It has to be worldwide. You don't do things just construction service that delivers test beds to users. And it's a lot of hardware, software, a lot of hardware assistance engineering, a lot of enterprise quality software development, the service management, operational monitoring, and call analysis. And then once all that was in place, we have to find a way of merging it into the ecosystem of GE and the Fed for Fire programs, programs in the Pacific region. And at the end of the day, we have to look at how we get the users on board. We have to go out, we have to talk to conferences like this, attract users to say, come use this service. We have to work with those research programs so they understand how to take advantage of this, teach them, training, and we've got to get feedback, right? This is the first release of this service, so we don't expect it to do everything. And it's got a long-term commitment, so if it doesn't do something the research community requires, then we want to fix it. So how does it work? So we have our user, our researcher here, comes up with this great idea and conceives of a network, some sort of infrastructure out there that we would like to put in place to test the idea. He goes to the John Testnet service and logs in and defines a network topology that he wants to use. This includes parameters like where I would like nodes and I want one in Copenhagen or I want one in Bratislava or one in Amsterdam. And this information goes into a document, we call it a DSL, I'll get to this in a minute, but it goes into a document that describes the network. That document gets fed to the Jean resource manager. This is the provider side of this whole equation. This is where Jean actually does something for the user. The Jean resource manager goes out, finds the resources or creates the resources, and then assigns it to the user. And at the assigned time, remember this is reservation driven, these resources become active and we pass control back to the user. And now the user can monitor them, can modify them, you can log into them and do things like their virtual machines or virtual circuits. And so this is in a nutshell, this is how the whole testbed service works. So internally, it's useful to understand the model that we have. So we have a network. What we do is we treat a network as a graph, nodes and links. But we take it one step further. We treat the links and the nodes generically as resources. Resources have data flow boards that allow us to define where data flows enter or exit these resources. And then we define adjacencies that define how these resources are related to how these data flows are actually placed to create the topology. And so this Deroid resource graph is kind of an interesting way of looking at these networks because everything's a resource and we have these adjacencies that's described how they're connected up. And so we put all the descriptors of all the parameters and attributes of the resources or entities and resource objects. And the topology of the network is captured in these adjacencies. We start out with a bunch of equipment. Now, in this case, these piles of equipment, these groups of equipment might be in different cities around Europe. And there's a virtualization layer of software that manages this infrastructure. And when it's required or a priority, we can take this infrastructure and we essentially create a set of virtual resources from that infrastructure. Those virtual resources are managed by the resource manager, the Jean resource manager. And when a user agent contacts the resource manager through the API, we can ask for the resources, we allocate the resources, and through that allocation process, what may not be obvious from this, from for this diagram, that we can do things, we can do some interesting things here. This whole virtualization layer here can be replicated multiple times. We can stack it. So we can take, for instance, the hardware server platforms. We can create one set of resources that might be a bare metal node, you know, just a raw server. We can allocate that. Or we could have a virtualization process that asks for one of these resources and then installs the hypervisor and creates virtual machines on that resource. So we can stack these things. Some features, other features we have, the domain-specific language. We thought it was important that we have a way of describing these test beds, and as it turns out, the resources as well, using a grammar that is specifically intended for this purpose. And a couple of reasons for doing that. We want to be able to create an object-oriented construction method so that we can scale these test beds descriptions up to very large constructs in a way that actually allows us to test things as we plan. And this also gives us the ability to do some things like programmatically defining objects that exist. We can find iterators and say, for instance, if you want to create the data center test bed, you can create a data center rack, right, that has 64 processors in it, virtual machines. And you can create this object called a data center rack. Then you can replicate that 64 times or 128 times. And you can have 128 of these racks in your test bed and connect them up. And then you say, all right, here's my data center object. And I can stamp out five of those and say, all right, now if I want to look like Google, I can say I have one of those in Copenhagen, one of those in Seattle, one of those in Tokyo. And we can build incrementally larger, more complex, sophisticated networks. We have a couple of tools. The command line interface is just a shell tool that allows us to access this API so that we can build shell scripts to manipulate these resources and test beds. And we've also developed a graphical user interface, a GUI, a web-based GUI that you can log into. And this is the primary way we expect users to interact. They'll log into this web GUI. And that will allow them to upload these DSLs, these test bed descriptions. And it will allow them to then manipulate them, to reserve those resources, to activate them or deactivate them, or query them. It also gives us access to the console interface for VMs. And it gives us access to some other primitives that are resource specific. So describing the network, let's delve a little bit into how this all comes together for the user. The user has this notion of a simple network with two hosts and a link in between them. The first thing we want to do is define logically this thing called a testbed, a testbed context, as we call it, an object. And we see that start up here with just this paragraph class description. So you're starting to see already this. Like certain high-level languages that we're all familiar with. The next thing we want to do is define two I/O ports, two ports that allow us to flow information into our testbed or out of our testbed. And so we just define these ports, LP1 and LP2. The next thing we want to do is define a host resource. And there's a library, I don't show it here, but there's a library that has this host template defined. So we just define an instance of the host. We call it, we name that instance H1. It's a type host. It has a parameter here. This parameter says it's like this in CPH. We do the same thing for second host. This one is in Bratislava. And then we do the same thing for the link resource. And the parameter for the link resource, of course, is something different. It's called bandwidth, so we can say how fast that might be. Now, one thing that we have to do now is set the adjacencies and say, right, how are these ports, how are these data flow ports connected amongst the resources? So there's
there's just these adjacency statements that define the internal adjacencies and then the external adjacencies that take outside the test altogether. So this bubble diagram is the logical concept of how you should be thinking of your test bed conceptually. The text on the right is an example of the domain-specific language that describes this. This is the description that gets passed between the user agent and the provider. And then the last thing we do is we instantiate the testbed. Up until this point, up here, we've just defined the template, the class. We just define what the object is. Here is where we actually instantiate and say, we'd like to do this now, and we'd like to run it until July 1st. I got changed on the date. I'll put it December 1st or 2025. Another feature of the main specific language, we've actually implemented the language on top of Ruby, which is another object-oriented language that's getting a lot of attention now. And one of the advantages of doing this, we can take advantage of all the Ruby constructs that help us define our language. For instance, iterators. Here's where we can. This is where we define a loop iterator that we can then use inside other constructs to create names of objects or to reference objects so we can set adjacencies and such. And by doing this, we can programmatically create huge topologies by just snapping this stuff out through these loops. So this is a very powerful feature. We haven't explored it, I think, very much at this point, but we're still, our users and our examples are still pretty trivial. But this is going to be very powerful, I think, as we go forward. Our resources. There's a whole ontology of resources. I mean, we have computational resources that turn out to be things like hosts. These are the vertices of the graph. These could be hosts, they could be switching and forwarding nodes. We have transport resources, which are virtual circuits. And in the future, we're also going to have things like broadcast domains, point to multi-point, or multi-point to multi-point transport resources. And then we have a third class of resources called composite, which are simply containers for the others. Right? So this is how we build object-oriented test beds, by defining composite constructs, putting other resources inside those, and then referencing that composite application. So how do we control these resources? All resources are required to support what we call the gang of five. Okay? These are simple and basic lifecycle primitive commands to reserve a resource or to release that reservation. We can activate a resource or deactivate a resource. Activating puts it in service for the user. It has to be within the reserve window. Deactivating takes it out of service but holds the reservation. You might want to do this for maintenance purposes or something. I've got this long-lasting test that is going to last for 6 months. I need a weekend where I'm going to do some maintenance, so I can deactivate it, hold the reservation, we can do some other things and activate it. And then, in addition to these five basic primitives, each resource can define additional extension primitives that may be very specific to a particular type of resource. For instance, an overflow switch might have a set data path ID primitive that allows you to manipulate that. That's not something you can do, strictly speaking, in OpenFlow. You'd have to log into the switch, the physical switch itself, to set that. And that would violate some privileged functions. So we do that by implementing it as the provider side does it. The user interface, right now with version one, the user interface is largely there to manipulate the lifecycle primitives, right? You edit your test bed description using just a conventional text editor, Emacs or VI or some other editor, and then upload that file. In version two, which will be available in 2 or 3 months, we're going to have a whole drag and drop point and click editing process, so you can construct your network graphically rather than just text and click it. So what does this look like technically? We have distributed through Europe a set of what we call pods. These are just racks of equipment. I think XOP would call these racks. But we call them pods. They consist of a control plane switch, data plane switching infrastructure, compute nodes for virtual machines or maybe other servers for hosts. And we have an open flow switch in there that we can partition into virtual switches. And so each pod is architecturally the same, but the actual infrastructure equipment complement might be different. So we have these pods in each city, and then we have a component called the central server facility. This is where the GTS service provider agents run. This is where OpenStack agents run. This is where the NSI agents run. So there's a lot of processes that are required to run the service. And those are all currently co-located with the pod and co-located. In the future, we're gonna have redundant server facilities so that now we have more reliability, but this is the way this is today. So our initial deployment started with Copenhagen and Bratislava. We added Ljubljana and Amsterdam, and we have those in a full mesh of, so we have these pods in each of these locations. A pod can support 3 or 4 virtual open flow switches, something on the order of 10 or 15 virtual machines, and virtual circuits, Ethernet over MPLS encapsulated virtual circuits. So phase one, this is what we got installed last summer. We've been working to complete some external links to the Postman Supercomputing Center in Kansas City in Poland, and into a university lab in Spain, EAU. And the connection to Exogene in North Carolina, Julia's project in North Carolina. So all of these should be demonstrable by supercomputing in 2 weeks. And these are good examples of outside ports. In phase two, we're going to be adding and reconfiguring some of these. We're going to add Paris, Hamburg, Milan. These three sites will be online probably January timeframe. And if we can, we're going to add 4 more sites by the April timeframe. Frankfurt, Zagreb, Lumina, London, right? So over the next 6 months, we should have approximately 12 sites set up throughout the European footprint. And then we're going to be progressing down the line, getting some of the immigrant partners to deploy this into their regions also. So our timeline, we started this in April of 2013. We were supposed to be online January this year, but for a number of reasons, we missed that deadline. I'm not proud of that, but it's the way it is. We brought those first 4 sites up this summer, and we're continuing to scale it up this fall and into next spring. There's a number of innovations we've done on this that we think are important. We we have this technology agnostic service model, so we're not relying on any specific hardware technology in the infrastructure to provide a service model. We have a formal virtual resource model. This is a derived resource graph, the DSL to describe these networks. The reservations are guaranteed. What happens a lot of times is we get lazy and we schedule these resources, but we don't actually guarantee the resources in the infrastructure in the future. And when we're doing these orchestration and trying to coordinate these kinds of tests with outside facilities, it's really important that these commitments are guaranteed and are guaranteed to the. The encapsulated virtual service, I think, is important also because it doesn't rely on Ethernet or switching. It allows the user to define their own VLAN space, whatever they would like to use. And we're using NSI for the provisioning of the service, which allow us to get it well beyond the GTS environment into the NRAMs and across into facilities in the U.S. and Asia. A couple of surprises, and then we'll take some questions. This notion of SDX has come up, and this wasn't what we were thinking of when we started this, but it's gaining some momentum here, and I think there's some value to this notion, so I want to promote it. We had a discussion in Sweden about 3 weeks ago, and Mike and Zink and Joe really promoted this notion of an SDX as a service that used open exchange facility that provides a broad range of what I call multi-species resources, computational resources, storage resources, transport, switching and forwarding, and supports an SDN control model. Right? So that's good. Now you start thinking about this, there's value here, right? We're not just putting pipes across our transit networks, we're putting services across our transit networks. And this is critical. But why limit this to exchange points or our traditional exchange points, something like Starlight or Netherlight or this sort? I would assert that we really want to extend this network through this, an extension of this concept. So I would assert the GTS, this geotestnet service, is a good example of an SDX. It's certainly not the only one out there. There's a lot of areas still, it's still a research topic, still emerging, evolving concept. But I think this is important, is that we can provide these facilities to various research islands around Europe right now. And we can give them an exchange fabric in the middle to have all these other resources. And we can do this for multiple affinity groups. We can do this for some high energy physics group. We can do it for bioinformatics group. And we can do this, as long as it can tell forever. A couple surprises, OpenStack killed us. This SDX concept is gaining a lot of interest. I'm going to stop there. The rest of these slides are futures, right? Where these are going over the next 2 or 3 years. But I'll skip to the last slide to say that this service is out there now. We're in early production. I should have put the URL on there. It's just gts.jot.net. And we have a very open user access policy right now. If somebody wants to just try it, it's almost brain dead simple to go try it. There's a long-term commitment from John for this, so it's not something that's just going to be around for a year. It's already been funded as phase one in October. This starts in April, and I expect it to continue on beyond that. So research can rely on it being there in the future. They can learn to use it. So I will leave it at that. Thank you. And I'll take any questions.
Thank you, Jerry. So we have time for questions. I don't think we have we have time for this. So there is one here first. This is the domain of the wine community.
Just a question. What is the level of integration do you have with the Genie project right now? What level of integration?
We're starting with data plane here, right? So we're putting these tunnels from the John GPS edge across the ocean and into the U.S. and we're crossing up into, for instance, Exergy in North Carolina and into their edge. And then the researchers, wherever, once that link in the GPS, our researchers pulls up a network of GPS, they can grab that port, and then they have a clear, transparent tunnel to Exergy in North Carolina. And they can do whatever they want, full range of VLANs and such. The next step will be to provide some level of interworking at the control plane. But that's going to be a little bit more difficult because we don't have exact control plane edge, right? The bigger question there is going to be how we create a common service. And this is going to be bigger than just XOD and GTX. It's going to be kind of a global discussion about how we create a standard model for this. And it's going to take some time. It's not, strictly speaking, a technical issue. It's a political issue. How we get people to agree to different aspects of these different features. Second example might have a different latency, and that can I don't know if it's an easy, it's certainly not an easy thing to enforce. So I would encourage, I'm certainly open to suggestions and discussion about that. I agree with you, we need to have some set of tools for performance analysis. As for the on the descriptions, this notion of semantically equivalent networks, it's very difficult to capture every potential aspect of a virtual resource. The way I think we fall into a trap if we try and expose every knob that we could to the user. What I think is more useful is to say, here's a resource, and here are the knobs and the attributes that we will have. And if those aren't sufficient, they come back to us, and if we will iterate, we will come up with a more refined version of that resource that may offer other attributes or characteristics that we can use. And then we can promote those resource descriptions and we can connect to those in the test cases. I think that goes a long ways to addressing some of that complexity. And Mike, do you have a question?
Yeah, we have a last question from Mike.
Thank you. I don't know, maybe pretty quick. Just maybe something we can also discuss a little bit more offline. I would be interested in what you're doing on the European side to engage domain scientists into your activities, physicists and others. And it would be nice to kind of see what we're trying on the US side, what you're trying on the European side. Someone who's coming from the US with background there, it would be nice if we could talk about at some point in time about the activities we're trying to engage with the folks in the
US. Yeah, I'll just make a couple of comments about that. Hey, while I was given the mission of building test beds for network research, these test beds don't just apply to network research and bioinformatics. Anybody who's building an application that a globally distributed big data application can use the same technology to explore different topologies, different service models for their business. And you can take this one step further. It says, now the Dante people are running, I kind of scratched your head when I pointed this out, says that they said this is just for test beds. When they want to go production, I have to kick them off. Okay? And I'm going, oh wait, these guys just spent 2 years building test beds, evaluating, rebuilding test beds, refining they have a working model. Just as it's ready to go, I've got to kick them off and they've got to go to a different environment. That's crazy. So this is a notion of where we have to build mind share both within the research community and in network management. It says these kinds of network environments are not just a requisite. These are not just toys. These are real networks. When we allocate virtual circuits, it's real bandwidth. Virtual open flow switches is real hardware. Right? These are real networks, and there's no reason we should have to take the users off right when they're getting production. So, I'll leave it.
Thank you.